Everybody, I chose this topic because whenever somebody says plastic surgery, the first thing that comes to everybody's mind is breast and augmentation. But actually, why I use this word aesthetic breast surgery was because aesthetic lies in the eye of the beholder. So the ideal shape and size is subjective to a personal preference. So what is good for one person may not be good for another. And that's how the aesthetic lies in the eye of the beholder. So I started with augmentation mammoplasty, but that was the thing which brought the plastic surgery into the world. So a person might want a natural look, or a person might want an enlarged or augmented look. So the indications, very few indications are there. Hyperplasia, the child doesn't have the woman or the child, the lady doesn't have a big enough breast for the lady, asymmetry, and tubular breast can be captured and be given a proper shape. Then after changes, after ptosis, after lactation, and after multiple births, after you do a mastopexy, they can be augmented. We usually use an implant. On autologous fat block, I'm talking only about implant now. So the implant is something like this, which looks like a jelly, a firm consistency. And like any other alloplastic implant is left inside a body, it has to be inert, should not react with the body fluids, should be easy to work with, and it should be non-carcinogenic. So we have a few implant types. The ones we use now is silicone. It's an elastomer, a polymer with a number of cross-linked chains. It is a fluid. And then when the cross-links are increased, it becomes a gel. And becomes an elastomer with more cross-links and a longer chain, it becomes a silicone shell. So even now it is called saline filled, you know, the saline or a silicone filled. The only the content plays, but the shell is always silicone shell. And the shape can be discoid, round. Tear shape is what's called anatomical shape, you know, just like the normal hips. The double lumen is the ideal one, very expensive. And the surface can either be smooth or textured. They have it has its pros and cons. I will not go into it now. So the implant either round or the part of the anatomical shaped ones on the left side. So what is an ideal breast? Something of this venous bust. It gives us almost the ideal breast. Upper pole to lower pole ratio is 45-50%. And upper pole should be sloping, or lower pole should be convex. And the apex should have a nipple-linear compass, which should be about 20 degrees pointing upwards. That is the ideal one, just suggested by everyone. So what do we do when the patient comes to us? We have seen the size of the breast, we see the size of the nipple-linear complex. I'll call it MAC and so required asymmetry, ptosis. Everything has to be recorded meticulously. And documentation is very, very, very important. Take photographs, frontal, you have a profile photograph, and ultrasonogram to rule out any masses inside or something which might miss later on, and this should come back to us, no bone marrow. And approaches are many. We usually use the inframammary approach, which is very easy and you can push in the implant. We have used axillary because people are very conscious, cosmetically conscious, perianal and endoscopic, even through the umbilicus they are put in. The placement is usually subglandular, below the gland, or submuscular below the pectoralis, and now they use a dual plate where the it's very ideal as the implant is kept in both ends, subglandular and submuscular. So you can see the placements. The second one is in front of the muscle, that is subglandular, behind the gland. The third one is behind the muscle. Just to go through this, type is saline or silicone, shape is round or anatomical shape, can be placed either submuscular or subglandular. So the outcome, the expectation is very important. What we imagine and what the patient imagines should be the same. Sometimes they are pros apart, you know what they ideally think can be. So let's sit multiple sittings and then tell them what we want and what we want should be talked about properly. So there's no dissatisfaction from their side. So discussion should be thorough. So the outcome has to be good. But see that the pre-education, that is when you talk to the patient, is comprehensive, get an informed consent. And the pre-op planning and the post-op follow-up should be meticulous. They should know it's a complete. And of course, surgical technique is very important. I leave out all this hematoma infection stuff. They are very common, asymmetric can occur. The one pertaining to the implants is extrusion, where any foreign body can be split out. Wrinkling can occur, surface bumps or wrinkles. and migrates, can move from the side of the pocket, is not snug enough. And the main problem is capsular contraction. It becomes sort of solidified, you know, it's no more, the fill is not there. Very rarely rupture, but now people are bothered about this. Just implant acquired anaplastic last lymphoma, which is becoming quite common nowadays. So just an example, this is hypoplasia, the lady wants a bigger breast, we give to them, she feels better, and the augmentation sizes can range from 200 mm to 400 mm. But what we do usually in a government setup is, we use these only for the transgenders mainly, because most of this augmentation go to the private sectors, and what comes to them, to us, what used to come to us was transgenders, the male breast, very difficult to place, but there's no place, their skin, there's a minimal of subcutaneous tissue and bone. So placement becomes very difficult, and they come with, you know, when asked for 250 mL implant, they come with 400 mL implant. Getting bigger is better, so it's terribly difficult, and we have faced quite a lot of problems with that. Whether there is a yield, there has to be a gap. So I was thinking about augmentation and your bone protection. This is more painful for the patient and more useful also. Indication is hyperplasia, which can occur in a child. We have met somebody as young as 13-year-old girl who had needed a reduction of plastic because of gigantomastia, very huge size. What are the indications? Not exactly the size. The patient gets a shoulder pain. No, they cannot wear the bras which are good enough, and they get neck pain. And they come with inflammatory infection, especially fungal infection, the subdermal crease. And psychological, so they're embarrassed. They can't wear any tight-fitting garments, are very self-conscious, they carry some particular comment, very low self-esteem. So this is the hypoplasia we get. And this is how it looks after reduction. Our basis is to have dermal pedicle, because our problem is to maintain the breast surface to the nipple area complex. That is very difficult to create. And this is all very academic. You know, any pedicle can be superior, inferior, lateral, medial. But marking is always in upright position, because when the patient lies down, it goes off. These are very theoretical. So I'll just give a few examples how it can be the difference. The patients are really very thankful after surgery. See the change. You are taking as much as 1.5 kilos from each breast when you are operated. As usual, we have this complication, hematoma, infection, asymmetry. But what we are afraid of is the epidermal cyst, you know, because then once it comes, it can be recurrent. Because we de-epithelize a portion of the skin when we perform a pedicle, and if you don't do this properly, the patient can come back to the epidermal cyst. And as a slight changes in accentuation, it restores. So now that is the females, I'll go to the male part of it, because these are the ones we get more than the female counterparts. What is gynecomastia? Anybody knows it's a benign enlargement in the male. And it's very common, we have about 30-70% prevalence in our country, and occurs usually in adults, 68% of them, they are self-limiting. Within 2 years you wait, it can regress. And usually 75% regress, 25% come to us for correction. And they have a very deep emotional distress when these guys have it. You know, especially in the prayer group, you know, when they take bath and they go pray, in their t-shirts, you know, they are made fun of. What is very simple, you have an estrogen androgen complex. If estrogen is more, it stimulates breast tissue, then the item is antagonistic effect, the child, the patient gets a gynecomastia. Etiology, varied, idiopathic, common, physiological, and you have to keep in mind about tumors, testicular tumors, drugs like ATT, metabolic cirrhosis of the liver, and quite a other etiology has been available. Classification simple, as a small, medium, large, something like that, as simple as that, depending upon the skin axis. So again, I always come back to clinical examination, very important, take the history and examine, you know, very thoroughly, because usually, by sometimes very rarely come across a bilateral gynecomastia, and look for a tumor. It's not uncommon to have a breast CA in a male breast. And after that, look for the liver, because the liver tumors can cause this, and testicular tumors, always look at the 10th quarter. So our aim is to provide the patient with a normal contour, chest contour. He goes to the gym, it should not be made for us. And minimal scarring. And here also, the nipple area complex viability has to be maintained. So when we start operating, suppose you come at 13, we do not operate. We wait. And we usually wait the boys about 18 years old. especially at some 2 years after the puberty. No, we should hurry up and operate, because some people, some parents are so worried, they come to us and they say, do it fast, but we wait, we give them time. And the child should have waited for 2 years. And the severe enlargement, of course, when it comes to, even then, we wait for 18-year-old to be born, to be 18-year-old. And significant asymmetry with, of course, psychological morbidity, all of the indications. There is only surgical modality for this gynecomastia. Of course, when we were studying, it was Webster's, it's still the gold standard for the gynecomastia surgery. But now we have come to liposuction. It has become a very popular modality now, because we have a very less scarring, and even the hospitalization is less, and the outcome is very good. We don't have the saucerization, and it sort of gives a very good finish. I think I'll skip this. When it is fibrous, more fibrous tissue, we go into an open method. But even then, nowadays, we've got such strong suction apparatus, we can go ahead with liposuction. Important, I usually put this slide for the youngsters. When you come for gynecomastia, please look at the liver function, for the tumor, look for renal function, and do a thyroid function test, and all the serum hormone levels, and mandatory ultrasound of the breast, abdomen, and testes to do not any mass on the breast. Very simple liposuction, minimal scarring, very invasive, because it's only a tubular cannula, and the contouring is very good. There doesn't give any lumpy feeling. If it is done well and it's a single modality, there's no time compared to the removal. Open test with subbrachial incision, remove the gland also, if it's not possible. Very simple types. Those are the, like what you call this SAS, suction assisted laparotomy. Now we have power ester, those are very tiring. Then now power ester is easier, and ultrasound, laser, and vascular assisted. The procedure has just a simple one. Have a pre-op documentation, important. Then mark the intramammary fold in the patient's sitting here, and mark all the concentric layers, you know, to know which area has to be suctioned. When the patient lies down, you see there's a small change. Even that makes submammary, if you see the lines, there are opposite difference. This makes a lot of difference when it comes to cosmetic surgeries. So GA, we usually use GA, made up of antibiotic, and the tumescent infiltration is very important. And we wait for about 20 minutes, then suction it out. All these techniques, I think, I will limit. But the aspirate will begin with the golden yellow color, with all the globules will come out, and so subsequently will be bloody. And then when we feel, it's enough to stop. And the stick, if you see, is rounded, what is called as a Mercedes stick, you know, so damage of tissues doesn't happen. And the one, the lowermost one is the one with multiple causes of tumor cell infection. The aspirate varies from golden yellow to the red color, and usually for both breasts we have a separate aspirate to know how much was aspirated for each breast. After this, all very technical, no jawbone saucer deformity means feather the thin cannula, no bottom surroundings, towards the submammary, everything. But drain is mandatory, it is kept in the little drain comes out, and pressure dressing is also mandatory, especially preferably for 4 to 6 weeks post. You can have any type of pressure garment depending upon the patient's willingness and what his occupation, how much he goes out. The usual hematoma, serum, or infection complex, but what we are scared of is the skin with the necrosis. Sometimes they have a contour deformity, may not look equal, asymmetrical. And skin redundancy, we do not excise skin. The skin has its own inherent elasticity, so it will bounce back. Usually it does after pressure garment is applied. So just a few photographs to see how, what a difference it makes for the male chest. It's a lateral view. Same here. And this was a tubular breast in a male. So reduced. And the other modalities for academic reason. But we have an, this is, what's that? This ultrasound liposuction is very good because it's quite fast and less taxing on the surgeons. But they are very rarely we do come across the problem wise because we don't use it properly. So I think I'll stop with this. This is our Indian sculpture. It's not the Indian breast, of course. Thank you.
Leaving of male gynecomastia with normal organ function, does it increase the chance of breast cancer?
That
you don't do anything. Is there
no, 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 sir, no, sir.
No chance.
No, no chance. No.
Thank you, ma'am. I know you like, I was a great thing, Dr. Gopal Dijaj, over here.